GearNetwork.com.
The following is a presentation of the Gear Radio Network.
I believe it's a big challenge for our building to keep things in perspective and to if we're going to get addicted to anything, let's get addicted to the process.
And with that, we welcome you to Trust the Podcast, episode number 74.
Episode 69 plus 5.
You know, I almost forgot how the podcast started. This is the Bi-Weekcast, by the way. It's going to be a goofy episode just because when it comes to the bi-week episodes, we try not to, I guess, stick to the script, if you will. I mean, honestly, the furthest I got this week writing the script is changing the title on the Google Drive document that we use to record the podcast. So with that being said, I am Ryan Wolfe at WolfBLTD, joined on the IndyCar Media Hotline by John Cimino at IMJC Money. John, how are you doing on this Thanksgiving Eve?
I am fresh out on bail of Facebook jail, California dreaming. Soon as I step on the scene, I'm hearing the haters screaming, my man.
Damn, that was real good.
Came off strong there, huh?
Well, hey, you know what? I've had the past few days off. I know that you are out of work today. You've got Thanksgiving, nothing but Thanksgiving to look forward to, I should say. It's been nice to kind of have a couple days off on my end and just kind of and just relax and get caught up and be terrified by the latest developments in the COVID-19 pandemic that is happening. But we can talk about that in just a little bit here. But before we jump in, I do want to mention the Buffalo Bills, despite being off last week, they had a week for sure. Now, we had seen the Miami Dolphins. Tua Tagovailoa was having a damn good time in his first few starts as a starting quarterback in the National Football League. But the Buffalo Bills get themselves quite the break last week while they had their bye week. I'm just scrolling down here to some scores. Miami loses to Denver 20-13. That pushes Miami to 6-4. If Miami had won, there would have been a tie atop the AFC East with Buffalo having the tiebreaker. And then looking at, let me see here. Oh, also the Patriots lost and obviously the Jets lost, which we'll talk about in just a bit. But the Buffalo Bills get that break, John, that they really needed. They really needed Miami to kind of falter against one of these lesser teams, and Miami did that, which still gives Buffalo some breathing room atop the East. Aside from that, though, there's not real much football stuff to talk about because the Buffalo Bills had a pretty uneventful week.
Well, I would say if you've heard the terminology before and you have won the bye week or lost the bye week or anything like that, this was definitely a major win in the Bills cap. They didn't have to play football in order for that to happen. Every team in the division lost. They gained a game on every team and yep. Didn't have to do a thing. I mean, you can't script it any better than that. Now, where we were coming into the bye week with Miami was on there. It was, you know, the Buffalo Bills were hearing footsteps from Miami. Now, all of a sudden it's, whoa, wait, Miami kind of got, you know, a reality check there and lost the game. And now what seemed like footsteps are starting to come a little farther away. So Miami has to regroup a whole hell of a lot more than Buffalo needs to right now at this point.
I would absolutely agree with that one. I'm just looking right now at the Buffalo Bills schedule. The one big change, the only real change that the Buffalo Bills experienced this week, the week 15 game at Denver was pushed to Saturday, flexed, I should say, to Saturday, December 19th at 4:30 PM. I guess, John, that really kind of gives me a nice little flow into, I guess, our three big things, which I don't have three big things this week. That's why I'm kind of.
We don't really need three big things. We could just talk this one through. I mean, it's.
That's kind of what I'm
again,
I'm playing.
They're not here. They didn't play, so it's not like we're recapping last week's game.
I'm rolling through it. We're having fun with it, you know?
But look at this, Ryan. Think about this, man. Before Trust the Podcast came on, when was every Buffalo Bills game on?
1 o'clock.
Sunday at 1, right? 1 o'clock. Right now, here we are, season number 4 of
Trust
the
Podcast.
And
that's what I was going to mention.
And we have a Monday night game, a Sunday night game, a Thursday night game.
You've got
Saturday
Buffalo,
game.
Buffalo hosting the Chargers on Sunday, which we'll talk about in just a few minutes, at 1 o'clock on the 29th. Then you've got the Bills not playing again until they're in San Francisco to face the 49ers on Monday night at 8:15 p.m. Then the week after that, they host the Pittsburgh Steelers on Sunday Night Football at 8:20 p.m. on the 13th, which is my dad's birthday.
Happy birthday, Randy.
You move to the next week. They face the Denver Broncos, as mentioned, at 4:30 p.m.
The only person besides Randy Savage with the name Randy that I actually find cool. That's a shoot.
That's a story for off the air. And then week 16, they take on the New England Patriots on Monday Night Football once again. And then they play the Dolphins at 1 o'clock on Sunday, week 17, which will likely stay the same. If I'm not mistaken, John, don't they only do 1 and 4 o'clock games on week 17? I can never remember that.
Week 17 is, yes, 1 and 4 o'clock games. No, they do a Sunday night game, I think, as well. I don't think Monday Night Football. I think Monday Night Football ends week 16.
Let me double check that really quick, just because that's honestly because logistically, John, the way we're looking right now, and I don't want to get too far ahead of myself before verifying this. No teams, obviously. Yeah, no joke. Okay, so yeah, all games are at 1 or 4 on week 17. So that game, so the Bills will play 1 o'clock this Sunday, 1 o'clock on week 17, and that's it for 1 o'clock this season. I mean, they're in prime time, and you're gonna have eyes all over them.
Right, you're gonna have eyes all over them, and you know that whenever the Bills are hit prime time, that is one of the highest rated games of the season is whenever the Bills play in primetime. And I think they must have noticed that last year, because this year they certainly have more. But I think what makes this a little bittersweet for me as a Western New York resident is, damn, if there wasn't COVID happening right now, you know.
Oh yeah,
all those games, like the Sunday night game and you know, all of the primetime games, like the bars would be filled, you know, for their away games. The stadium would just be absurd. Like, I would literally drive up there to drive Uber, you know.
It's not a bad idea.
For that game. Like, I would start up there at 9 o'clock in the morning, and I wouldn't leave until after the game. Cause that would be a freaking killing for if you were an Uber or Lyft driver there. That would be a great time. Now they're going to have the Bills Mafia is going to have their great time either way. There's no stopping them for that. But how cool would it have been if it were a normal world with this schedule, this late in the season, with this much on the line right now?
It would have been absolutely fantastic, especially as you mentioned, with all the eyes on the Buffalo Bills, and people are definitely they're jumping on the bandwagon. I mean, and rightfully so. Josh Allen's been fantastic. The Buffalo Bills offense has been fantastic. I mean, they have that bittersweet loss to the Arizona Cardinals from week 10. But honestly, at this point, it's 10 time of recording 10 days ago. And that seems like eons ago, I guess, is the best way to put it. It doesn't feel like it's lingering over this bye week. It just feels like it's another week where the Buffalo Bills are going to be hosting a lesser opponent, if you will.
Right.
And moving forward from there, just to go get the victory and move one step closer to that AFC East.
Honestly, I'm looking at when I look ahead of the schedule there. I know last week we talked about, off of the Bills subject there, that this is a season where we could possibly get a 16-0 and an 0-16 team in the same season. I don't know that I see the Steelers beating the Bills this year, though. I mean, I know the Steelers are good, but when the Bills turn it up, they can compete with anybody. And I think that game could be the proverbial punch in the mouth for the Steelers. It would not shock me if the Steelers finish 15-1, losing to Buffalo,
especially because I believe if the Ravens win this week and there a couple other teams lose, the Steelers can clinch a playoff berth. So it's coming to the point where they're getting down to the nitty gritty already, where they may not have much to play for. So it certainly is a situation where, I mean, obviously we know you play to win the game, you come and try to win every single football game, but when you're already in the playoffs, we know how teams can kind of take a back seat and relax a little. If you've got a team firing on all cylinders, like the Baltimore Ravens this Sunday or the Buffalo Bills coming in a few weeks. You may get a little more than you ask for or want to ask for or want to be able to handle just because you're worried about your eyes being on the prize and being ready for the playoffs, whereas the Buffalo Bills or the Ravens or whomever may be looking forward to trying to just lock up that playoff berth or that playoff seed to get themselves in the playoffs.
Oh, I agree. I mean, I breaking down the wall here, I'm multitasking and handling some other Gear Network projects as well while you're going on. Just refresh me on what you just said, what you had just finished off with.
Well, I was just saying that teams are more hungry. It may be a situation where they face some teams that are a little more, I guess, raring to go, a lot more on the line than the Pittsburgh Steelers, who may not be. They may be able to take the foot off the pedal, I guess, if you will.
Yeah. And I think it would be, unless they feel like they legitimately want to try for 16-0, they totally should. And I would, support them trying that, because, for the amount of 0-16s that we've seen, which has been two and possibly three thus far, we've only seen 1-16-0, at least in my lifetime. So I wouldn't mind seeing that again, because I thought that was a pretty cool accomplishment. But that said, to your point, with the Steelers, if they wind up being, far enough ahead to where they clinch the playoff berth, I mean, yeah, what's to say, if they win, they win. If they lose, who cares? Because we're going to try and keep, Roethlisberger healthy and Juju healthy and all those guys and their defense rested and stuff like that for the playoffs, so that way they could turn it back up again and hopefully compete with, for them, compete with the Kansas Cities and the Buffaloes of the world in the playoffs. Now, when I look at the schedule in terms of the Bills, realistically, as I'm scrolling through what's left here, if they lose two remaining games, that would be where I could see them losing to the Steelers and the Dolphins, but I can also see them beating both. This is going to be a really interesting stretch, because the Bills could, in theory, win out. I think they're good enough to win out, but I also think they're, good enough to lose two as well. So this is going to be a very, very interesting stretch to see where I don't think that the Bills will lose the division. I think they're going to win the division, but I want to see what momentum they bring into the playoffs. Sure. Are they going to be riding after the heartbreaking loss to the Cardinals? Could they ride a 6-game winning streak out into the playoffs? Would they be tired if they did that? Would they rest the starters against the Dolphins if they have it locked in and that game not matter? Or if the Dolphins are on the cusp of earning a playoff spot, do they want to play spoiler and keep them out? So many different scenarios, Ron. Absolutely. So many different scenarios.
And we're only heading into week 12. Like we said, it's a day before Thanksgiving, but looking at it right now, John, the AFC as is follows. You've got the Steelers at 10-0. They're the 1 seed, the Chiefs 9-1, the 2 seed, Buffalo, the 3 seed at 7-3, the Colts 7-3. They are the 4th seed. The Titans are 7-3, the 5th seed. The Browns are 7-3. They've played very well against bad teams, mediocre against good teams. But hey, if you beat bad teams, that's what you're supposed to do. And then you go from there. And they certainly have taken advantage of that so far. And then wrapping up the AFC right now, the Raiders in Las Vegas, the Las Vegas Raiders, that's what I wanted to say, 6-4. So if the season ended today, John, which we know it won't, the Buffalo Bills would host the Cleveland Browns at Bills Stadium. It looks like right now, if the Bills are going to win the division, they'll most likely be the 3 or 4 seed, which means they'll either get, it's going to be interesting to see how that plays out, just because I'm thinking about it right now. And it looks like the Colts and Titans are both going to make it. You've got the Ravens. I mean, really, honestly, right now, the AFC is down to Miami at 6-4, Baltimore at 6-4, Las Vegas at 6-4. Then you've got Cleveland 7-3 and Tennessee 7-3. I'm going to be hard pressed to think that right now, either the Colts, who get, they've got Tennessee, but they get Houston twice. They get the Jaguars in week 17. I mean, that right there, they should be able to get the 10 wins at least. And they also get the Raiders as well, which actually would end up being a huge matchup. And then you look at the Titans, who face, they've got a relatively puff piece of a schedule. They get the Jaguars, the Lions. I mean, they have the Texans week 17. They do face the Packers and Browns. So it'll be interesting to see how that plays out. But I honestly think that the Buffalo Bills are obviously in control of their own destiny at this point in time. Mm-hmm. The Dolphins, I mean, they faced, let's see here. Let me see if this updated. Sorry, I got to double check this.
We know they're going to win this week against the
Jets. Oh yeah, absolutely. There's no doubt. There's no doubt about that. They face the Jets, the Bengals, but then they get the Chiefs, the Patriots, the Raiders, and the Bills. So these next 2 weeks, they might be able to roll off two wins with no problem. Mm-hmm. But then it's going to get real difficult because even though teams like the Patriots have not been playing great, it's still the Patriots. You still have to give them that. I still have that respect factor.
Their final four stretch, they could easily go 1-3 in that entire stretch.
Absolutely. Yeah. They could, they're looking at 6-4, but they could end up 8-8, 9-7 right. very easily,
which may or may not be good enough for a playoff berth in this restructured playoff format in this weird year here, but in the same, like, yeah, they're going to have to – I would think that if they were going to knock off another team and get to that 9 win, I think it would probably be – unless the Bills rest their starters and are no and don't really care about the Week 17 game, it could be that one. But I could see the Dolphins nudging out the Patriots and possibly the Raiders. But the Raiders are a weird team. Because
they've actually looked really good
and were, a Patrick Mahomes go away drive away from sweeping the Chiefs this season. You know, they're the Chiefs' only loss this season is the Raiders. So they're playing very tough. They're playing very good. So that's but in the flip, on the flip side of that, David Carr. Derek Carr, I always keep calling him his older brother. Derek Carr, he's a very good starting quarterback in the NFL, but he's good in a Ryan Fitzpatrick way, in my opinion, where he can flat out dominate and ball one game. And then he can also turn it over like 10 times, you know, like, I feel the Bills, we're beating the dead horse here. I feel the Bills are in prime position to kind of coast through the rest of this division, especially given their schedule. But they have to play pretty, they have to make sure they don't do what they did these final 6 weeks in dare say the first 4 weeks of the season, where they would get ahead and then take off the gas. Cause you know, Justin Herbert's playing pretty well, having a very impressive rookie campaign. The Broncos and Vic Fangio and, you know, the way he's got things going, they're a very up and down weird team that could do something crazy. You can't sleep on the Patriots. And if the Dolphins have something to play for, they're going to play tough. So the Bills can't really afford to slip and think that, oh, well, we're just going to cruise here and nothing bad will happen to us because we had a good bye week and we're everybody lost. Because, you know, you've got at least three of these teams coming to play for something.
It's crazy you mentioned Derek Carr. I was just looking at his stats while you were talking there. He's quietly 19 touchdowns, 3 interceptions on the season. It's weird too, John, because in their last 5 games, and I know this is a Bills podcast, but I just want to mention this because it's very weird. In the last 5 games, they are 3-2. In 2 losses, Carr has thrown for at least 275 yards. He threw for 275 against the Chiefs last week, which was a great ending to a great game, and then threw for 284 yards against the Tampa Bay Buccaneers 5 weeks ago. Sandwiched between those losses are 3 victories where he threw for, respectively, 111 yards against the Browns in Cleveland. It was a bad day, nasty weather, whatever. 165 yards against the Chargers in Los Angeles, and then 154 yards against Denver in Las Vegas. So it almost seems as if, and this seems kind of counterproductive, but at least the last 5 weeks, if he's not throwing for a lot of yards, better, or they're just, it's just weird how that breaks down. But looking actually at the splits here. Yeah. Let's see here. I thought it was going to break it down much better than I did. It just says wins and losses, but doesn't tell me how many yards he threw for. It's irrelevant. Either way, speaking of Justin Herbert, speaking of the Chargers and the Buffalo Bills, the Chargers are 3-7, 1-4 on the road, where the Buffalo Bills are 7-3, 4-1 at Bills Stadium. John, you mentioned Justin Herbert real quick before we talk about him. I want to talk about the Chargers real fast. They are scoring 26 points per game, allowing 27.3 points per game. Offensively, they average 412.4 yards per game. That's 291.1 yards passing, 121.3 yards rushing. Defensively, they allow 353.7 yards per game. That's 238.4 yards passing and 115.3 yards rushing. Now, Justin Herbert, the man of the hour, the sixth overall pick in the 2020 NFL draft. I almost said entry level draft as if this were hockey, but the
winning
the
NFL, both on and off the field, my man.
Yeah. He's been incredible this year. He's on pace for 4,318 passing yards, 35 touchdowns, 10 interceptions. And his completion percentage right now is at 68%. John, he has 26, almost 20, he's 1 yard shy of 2,700 yards, 22 touchdowns, 6 interceptions. And that is in, let's see here, 9 games played. Justin Herbert has looked everything that the Chargers thought that he would be as a future franchise quarterback. Granted, they sped up the process just a little because, you know, their team doctor stabbed Tyrod Taylor in the lung and collapsed his lung earlier in the season, which led to Justin Herbert essentially Wally Pipping Tyrod Taylor for the umpteenth time in his career. But Herbert has been great, arguably one of the best in the class. I mean, you could argue between him and Joe Burrow, but Herbert has been everything as advertised, and the Chargers are going to be set up for a very long time with this kid under center.
Oh, absolutely. And I think that they have the right guy as the head coach there, and Anthony Lynn, to help bring him up and keep that offense going in the right direction. I don't think that the Chargers are really going to. I could be wrong. This could be a punch in the mouth kind of game too, I suppose. But my gut is telling me I don't think that this is going to be that time for them, or at least with this team. I think the Bills are far more prepared on every aspect of the ball to handle this rookie quarterback. Next year at this time, if what we're seeing out of Herbert is improved on, and he takes the more Josh Allen approach, where he's not in terms of how he plays the game, but how he has developed and how the game has slowed down to him and how he's progressed. And I have no reason to believe that he won't progress just as well, if not better, than Josh Allen has. This could be a real problem 2 or 3 years down the line.
Sure.
If this were a similar situation where the Bills were playing them with a division, you know, with being in the division lead, I don't think they'd be playing a fourth place Chargers team 2 to 3 years down the line. I think they would be playing a Chargers team that would resemble more the Raiders, where they're on the cusp of, you know, they're definitely a punch you in the mouth kind of team. I am impressed with how he has developed before our eyes as quickly as he has. He seems very calm. He seems very poised. He seems like he understands the offense and he understands how to read defenses already, which is clearly evident by his stats that he's put up now, which, you know, through 9 games, I mean, historically, rookie quarterbacks that start have never, you know, don't tend to exceed 20 touchdowns or 30 touchdowns or things like that. And he's on the cusp of getting to that 30 touchdown platform in his rookie year. So it might be something for the Bills defense to really look out for, to see how he plays. But I think that the offense is going to do more than enough for Buffalo to hold them off.
And just looking at the Los Angeles Chargers, John, we talk about how good Justin Herbert is. Their defense has not been very good. They've blown a couple late leads. But also, if you look at their schedule, they've only beaten Cincinnati, Jacksonville, and the New York Jets.
I mean, that does tell you it. Now, but what is telling as well about some of these other scores? Like, listen to some of these other scores, though, because we talk about, yes, their wins are against Cincinnati, Jacksonville, and the Jets, and they're 3 and six now.
3-7.
3-7, excuse me. They're 3-7 now. But listen to these scores. Week two, Kansas City, 23. L.A., 20. Week three, Carolina, 21. Chargers, 16. Week four, 38-31, Tampa. 30-27, New Orleans. 31-30, Broncos.
Yep.
31-26, Raiders. 29-21, Dolphins. Like, they're
right there.
They're competitive. They're right there. Like, any one of these losses, any one of these seven losses could have been a win. Like, this team, you know, they come to play. They're not there. It's not like blatantly obvious now, like insulting your intelligence obvious, like how the New York Jets are doing, where they're, oh, we're not tanking. Yeah, MF-er, you are. Like, okay, at this point now, yeah, you are. It's so obvious. Just say it and shut up, you know. But the Chargers, this is a team that is 3-7, but they're playing like they want the respect put on their name. And it's usually teams like that are the very competitive 3-7 teams, yep. That finish maybe 4-12 or 5-11. Like, they're those competitive teams that, you know, they have the nucleus set up there, and all they need is just a little more seasoning. And then, and when they have a little more seasoning, they're going to be good. And then they can, sorry, the mail person was like looking in my window trying to see if I wanted to, and I tried to wave them over, but they didn't see. But whatever. Anyways, they can take the extra steps. They need it. But
yikes!
I'm kidding. They're awesome. I'm busting their chops. But you know, if this team, you know, ends up finishing how they finishing on the low end, and they end up getting a top five or top six draft pick, like, that could very well be a pick that takes them from whatever they finish this year, 4 wins, 5 wins, to 8 wins, 9 wins. Yeah. I mean, again, they could easily be up there competitive. They've lost a lot of these games by one score or less. So, but the Bills, this is a week that I think the Bills will win this game. Again, I'm not saying that they won't, but they can't do the whole take the foot off the gas the second half if they come out on fire in the first half thing again, because these Chargers are liable to punch you right in the face, I guess. And judging by these scores, this is not a game that the Bills should take lightly, especially that defense. That defense needs to come to work, because I'm not starting them this week in fantasy.
They better come to work. It's going to be a good game. Give me just a second. My dog is barking, which means I got to let him out. I'm just going to leave this in the podcast. I don't care. Just give me a second here, though.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, just like that, I'm back. It's like I took a quick commercial break. Looking at the Buffalo Bills, looking at some other news, just to mention here, first off, ESPN reports that Josh Norman has been activated from the reserve COVID-19 list. Norman, along with Levi Wallace, Dean Marlowe, and Tyler Croft, were all placed on the list the day before Buffalo traveled to Arizona. All four players have now been activated, and the Bills are nearing full health as they prepare to host the Chargers on Sunday. Tight end Tommy Sweeney diagnosed with a heart condition, what has been called myocarditis, a direct effect from the COVID-19 virus that has been going around. He's the first NFL player to have been diagnosed with this. Personally, I know that Boston Red Sox pitcher Eduardo Rodriguez also was diagnosed earlier this year, which forced him to miss, I think, the whole season, if I'm not mistaken. So again, a situation where COVID's still out there. COVID's very real. People are pretending it's not real. I know John in Monroe County, Andrew Cuomo, earlier today mentioned that from November 4th to November 24th, hospitalizations in the county that we live in, Monroe County, are up, I think, 237%. It's terrifying. But people, I guess, because of the holiday season, are not taking it seriously, as we mentioned. And for that, I don't thank you, because that's selfish behavior.
After last week, I'm going to remain mute.
You're going to plead the fifth?
I'm going to remain somewhat mute about it. All I will say is I share your sentiment, Ryan.
Thank you.
And you know, just just please, people, just a few more months. Just a few more months. We already did. We already got through 9 of them. You know, let's just get through a few more. We're almost there.
Hey, remember Patrick Surtain used to play for the Dolphins and Chiefs, or had played for the Dolphins and Chiefs?
Yes.
Apparently, I mentioned this because I was looking at a mock draft here, John. They this CBS Sports mock draft has the Los Angeles Chargers drafting his son out of Alabama, who's a junior, if you want to feel old.
Well, I already do, but thanks.
You're welcome.
I'm going to be older. I'm going to be older next at the end of next week. Thanks for that reminder, too.
I'm always here Jack for wagon. You, man. I'm always mm-hmm. here for you. Mm-hmm. So before we wrapped up this truncated edition of Trust the Podcast, I do want to mention, check out 26shirts.com, facebook.com/26shirts, at Twitter, or on Twitter, at 26shirts as well. John, I am Ryan Wolf. You are John Cimino at IMJC Money. I am at Wolf BLTD. I appreciate you taking the time here on this Thanksgiving Eve. It's not like Halloween where it's all Hallows Eve, although if I remember correctly, Thanksgiving Eve is the drunkest night of the year. Is that correct? When like everyone comes home and goes out to the bars and all that stuff?
That, well, yeah, I mean, you can't really, I think, do that now, but today, this year, but yes, traditionally, Thanksgiving Eve is a big night for the bars and all that type of stuff. It was a gigantic night for me as an Uber driver, 2 years ago. And even last year, from breaking down the personal wall here, not having the need to do that, thankfully, because of COVID, honestly, and being caught up and in a good place. I wouldn't have done that, but if I was like bored and didn't have the kids or anything and it was normal, I might go out and it would be very easy to make, as little as $100 in a matter of hours. That's how good it is for at least a good Uber or Lyft driver, cab driver, I assume too, in that business. So yeah, the bar industry is going to be taking a significant hit today, but you know, hopefully if everybody can just be nice and calm and smart for the next few months, this time next year, you can all be drunk idiots together.
Do you want a funny story? I agree with you. Do you want a funny story before we wrap up the podcast?
Oh, sure.
I had to drive to Batavia today to go pick up some gifts from my mother-in-law's house. Mm-hmm. I order gifts and send them there and come home and wrap them and all that stuff. I went to the gym, which I didn't want to, but I called them weeks ago in Planet Fitness and said, hey, I want to cancel my subscription or my gym membership. They said, you have to come into the gym. I said, that's stupid, but whatever. I'll do it.
Blink Fitness just did that to me too yesterday because they're on the cusp of the orange zone as well. And I'm and I call them and they're like, no, you got to come in. And I'm like, fuck you.
So I go there, right? Guess what I realize in the parking lot? Now, mind you, I have a handful of pairs of Crocs. Some here, some there, whatever. I get out of the car, and just as I'm about to get out, I realize I got a big old hunking pile of dog shit on my one Croc.
Oh, no.
So I walked right in with Crocs. I love Crocs, man. They're so easy to work in. I can get them dirty. I just spray them right off. It's great.
But you didn't spray the dog shit off.
Oh, I didn't realize it was there because there was a leaf stuck to my foot. And I'm like, what the hell?
Wait, realize that dog shit is not – dog shit smells.
Because –
does your car smell like dog shit routinely? And then you're just like no sensitive to it?
Here's the deal. I had a leaf stuck on the bottom of my shoe, which was a dog shit leaf. So when I get out of the car, I'm like going to get out. I'm like, why is there a leaf on me? And I pull it off and I just see shit. And I'm like, that's why it was stuck to my shoe. These shoes have been in my garage, so I don't smell them because it's really cold in there. So, normally when stuff is cold, it doesn't really smell. So I had to drive home from Batavia with my shoe moved away from the heat vent because it just kept smelling like heated up dog shit. But I walked in. I did walk into Planet Fitness. I showed them with my big old pile of poop on my foot. I don't know. I don't think they noticed. I don't think they cared. But I thought it was pretty funny.
I mean, depending on which Planet Fitness you walk into, there's odors that come out of there that smell far worse than leafed up dog shit on a crock.
Hey, it is what it is, but I wanted to share that wonderful story so you can all go enjoy your turkey and your ham and no Steelers Ravens, but you can enjoy watching the Cowboys and the Washington football team play what they call football tomorrow.
You know what? It'll be perfectly fine with me. I'll be drunk by then anyway. So I call that the Who Cares Bowl.
Who cares is exactly right.
Actually, you know what? They're playing for something.
They're legit tied for second in the NFC East. Yeah, and the winner who wins that game, I mean, Pittsburgh, the Dallas Cowboys have a very easy schedule. So I guarantee you, Mr. Perez, shout out Mr. Perez, he'll – When the Cowboys win the East, I'm sure he'll predict them to win the Super Bowl with like a 4-12 record or something. So we'll see. But with that being said,
it would be funny if a 4-12 team made the playoffs and won the Super Bowl. Though I can't lie, that would be hilarious.
That would be terrible. But hey, with that being said, John, you are at I am JC Money. I am at Wolf BLTD. I'm Ryan Wolf. Again, you are John. You know that. I know that. The listeners know that, but we try to remind them. As always.
Jesus Christ, Ryan, say the ending already.
As always, we are Trust the Podcast.
You're not.
We will catch you sometime very soon. Have a safe and happy Thanksgiving. Wear your masks, socially distance, and Black Friday shop online.
But shop local.
And go Bills. Go Bills. Go Bills. See you, bye.
The preceding presentation has been brought to you by the Gear Network.